against today?
Nettles got me bottom of the ninth.
Nettles hits a high fly ball. Deep right field. It is going to be up. The 1988 Montreal Expos, the next generation, brought to you by Labatt, brewers of 50 ale.
Got him. They've done it. Like the 1969 Mets, it's the impossible dream revisited.
Yes, the Dodgers had done it. They had bounced back from a fifth-place finish in 1987 to win it all in 1988. An encouraging sign for all teams looking ahead to 1989. As memories of baseball fade into frozen turf, leaves fall, obscuring base paths and pitcher's mounds, remaining as debris in empty dugouts and bullpens. Soon, the white of the baselines is replaced by a whiter blanket of snow, lending protection to the field, the bleachers, and the dreams of youth. A blanket that seems to caress with a promise of renewal, a winter slumber which is invariably followed by the return of spring. It starts to wake in Florida, where it seems it had never quite slept, where winter is a doze rather than a hibernation. The South, where other more placid pastimes mark the yearly transition between baseball seasons.
Program scorecard!
Buck Rogers and his team are getting ready. Fundamentals, with the stress on fun, is the order of the day. There is batting practice. There is pitching practice. Okay, there is even mandatory practice needed in learning to pose for photos.
We feel that we came a long way last year. We made great strides, and now we got to take the next step, and that's to win the division.
There's no slouches in our division, and we know that we're going to have to play better than we did last year to win this thing, and we plan on doing that. We worked hard this spring to get to that point.
We've got some things to improve on. We were third place last year. That's not good enough this year.
Everybody else has had their day in the sun. I think it's time for us.
And for the Expos, the 1988 run at their day in the sun began at home, opening day at Olympic Stadium. And to throw the first pitch, a favorite son of Montreal fans, Le Grand Orange, Rusty Staub. Fitting that the first ever opening day in Montreal should be accompanied by the first batted ball ever to hit the stadium rim in fair territory. The Mets used that particular strawberry homer and the long ball in general to spoil the Expos 88 opener. After a day off, following that off day, it was up to Pascual Perez. And Perez proved to be just what the doctor ordered as he wrote a winning prescription for a smiling Buck Rogers. One early season question mark revolved around the effect of the enclosed stadium roof on home runs. Despite the opening day barrage, the consensus was that the ball generally did not carry as well.
And Hubie Brooks missed a home run by 6 feet.
Under the watchful eyes of their fans, the Expos got it going in mid-April. First, Luis Rivera in the field. And at the plate. Comes to the plate. Then Tom Foley singling up the middle for a winning run.
Galarraga scores.
Galarraga gives. How about playing long ball with the cat for the Expos' third straight win?
4-2 Expos.
And again, instant offense. The home run stroke of Hubie Brooks leads the way to win number 4 in a row. Finally, Tim Burke in the bullpen nailed down a victory to make it 5 in a row.
You get another good look at it. And you
watch this play closely. Here's something you don't see every day. The Phillies didn't believe it, and Von Hayes will never forget it.
Tim Burke did a terrific job. The
The Expos have beat
score. All the world's a stage, and those of us upon it merely players. Shakespeare wrote that line, and William never even got to see Pascual Perez, baseball's consummate entertainer.
He is the quickest I've ever seen going from the mound to the dugout. And a lot of times I've seen him in the dugout before the ball was caught by an outfielder, and I've always wondered, what's going to happen if a guy dropped that ball?
The saga of Pascual Perez went from comedy to tragedy with this sting put on by a Nolan Ryan fastball. Thoughts of 20 wins became a Midsummer Night's Dream. The early season load was carried by Andres Galarraga. Home runs aplenty. He hit them outdoors in the rain. He hit them indoors in the dome.
Hits it a ton to left. The ball's going to be up, up and away. A two-run home run. And he threw a breaking ball.
He even inspired unexpected long ball from fellow countryman Johnny Paredes, who turned lights out on the Astros in extra innings.
Well, here's Johnny Paredes trying.
But in Atlanta, it was lights out for the Expos' young second baseman.
Hit in the head by Kevin Kaufman.
I still have my scorecard.
On May 2nd, Ron Robinson of the Reds had a perfect game through 8 2/3 innings against the Expos when he faced Wallace Johnson. Johnson ended that bid with this line drive. As a pinch hitter, Johnson had made a habit, and yes, a career, of doing just that to pitchers all through the National League.
Wallace Johnson's pinch hit, batting right.
You know, to me, it's one of those do-or-die things, and, you know, if you're going well, it's great, and when you're not going well, well, you know, it's a tough job, and you're just dying, so, yeah, the gratification is definitely there.
There is another side to Wallace Johnson. There is form as well as substance. Tax form, that is.
$10, I can't take that.
We promise you a refund.
I'm telling you, I
need a refund. You know? H&R Johnson.
I'm not from this country, man.
Yeah.
Johnson, an accounting major at Indiana State University, has helped several of the Expos organization players with their taxes over the past few years, mostly the young Latin players, and he does it for free.
I wish I could kind of like manipulate the numbers on the field like you can sometimes do with tax returns. So you can find a number here and there with the taxes, but in baseball, they're either there or they're not.
If August has its dog days, then what is it that May has? Buck Rogers was finding out, and he didn't like what he was seeing. Urgent mound conferences. Followed by dugout sonatas. The one bright spot for Floyd Yeomans was a one-hitter against the Giants on the 21st of May. Tim Wallach at third base was going for the gold once again. His defensive prowess was unequaled, and he won his second gold glove. Wallach also reached another milestone in 1988, 1,000 major league hits.
Getting Lee at first base. Now he's lifted it.
The organization's been great to me. The fans have had their ups and downs with me, which is part of baseball, but they've been pretty good to me. I don't think they've been unfair. I think they've booed when they deserved to boo, and I think they've cheered when they deserved to cheer.
Wallach feels at home in the Expos clubhouse. He enjoys the atmosphere and the camaraderie. But his wife, Lori, and son, Matthew, capture his attention away from the ballpark.
The organization wants to be at the top. It's been kind of up and down climb, so-called, the last few years, but I think we're back on the right track.
Power. The sun was shining with the roof hanging overhead when the Mets paid their second visit to Olympic Stadium. The bullpen nailed down wins in the first two games. Jeff Parrott with a save, followed by Andy McGaffigan. Then Hubie Brooks drove one up the middle to win game three. The Expos had got the Mets' attention.
And the Expos have done it.
Over the course of 162 games, there are peaks and valleys. Here's a peak at one of the valleys that occupied 2 weeks in June. There were passed balls that cost them runs, and smashed balls that failed to get past old friends.
First pitch of the day, and a sharp line drive, and Dawson.
But there's always a bright side.
Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps, just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing.
Always look on the bright side of life.
Come on.
Always look on the bright side of life.
For life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bow. Forget about your scene, give the audience a grin. Enjoy it, it's your last chance anyhow. And
always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life.
Come on, Brian, cheer up.
But then in late June, a double dose of Dr. Joe Sparks' miracle elixir came to cure the Expos' runs, or lack of same. Otis Nixon, a switch-hitting outfielder, dealt the Cardinals a dose of their own medicine.
Pena's throw to second into center field. Nixon picks himself up and goes on to third.
Infielder Rex Hudler found every which way to get around the bases. A bunt single.
A bunt single for Hudler as Obergefell charges it.
There goes the runner. A steal of third.
Throw to third, not in time.
And even this electrifying steal of home.
Steal, slide, scores. He scores.
Hudler and Nixon. There ought to be an investigation.
It could be those guys coming in from out of town.
Just because they have a reputation doesn't mean it was me. Check the other guys.
Hey, just because I'm the new kid on the block doesn't mean you have to blame me.
Hey, man, I was just doing my job.
What of the original thief, the mastermind of base crime in Montreal for all those many years? Well, he played through pain in 88, but he did have his moments. On July 16th against the Reds, Raines became the first Expo to homer from both sides of the plate in the same game, against Tom Browning, and then against Rob Dibble.
So I learned a lot from last year, and it's gonna be back to the drawing boards, and hopefully get back to the way I feel I'm capable of playing, the way I've been playing over the years, and I'm looking forward to it.
Veteran infielder Tom Foley always comes ready to play. A steady, oft-times spectacular fielder, Foley provides a balance of defense, and offense, sprinkled with a dash of power. But in late June and early July, the talk of the National League was the cat, Andres Galarraga. The slick fielding first baseman combines quickness afield with swiftness afoot. All the while defying gravity with some moonshots of epic proportion. Andres Galarraga, the Expos Player of the Year.
Well, I feel so happy for this season because I got a better year like I can do last year. So happy for myself because, you know, I surpassed my personal numbers.
Off the field, one of this cat's nine lives is that of an artist, where outdoor scenes are his specialty.
That's something great for me because I'm forgetting everything when I'm painting. This concentration, what I do, and I feel really happy like that.
You can do magic. You can have anything that you desire. Magic. And you know you're the one who can put out the fire. You know darn well when you cast your spell, you will get your way when you hypnotize with your eyes.
The 1988 All-Star Game was in Cincinnati. The Expos were represented by Buck Rogers.
In the All-Star Game, I couldn't make it as a player. I didn't have the talent. But to be here as a coach is an honor. And someday, hopefully, I'll manage this thing, and that'll be the ultimate honor.
And by Andres Galarraga. Galarraga made his mark in his first All-Star Game appearance with an outstanding defensive maneuver.
He's put two back-to-back 300 seasons together, 90 RBIs. So I think he's here to stay. I think he's a candidate for the MVP award in the National League, and hopefully he'll get it.
The 3-2 to James. He struck him out. Dennis Martinez matches a career high with 10 strikeouts.
Dennis Martinez was the leader of an Expos starting staff, which was the strength of the team. He won 15 games and posted a 2.72 earned run average, ninth in the National League. After a
strenuous outing Friday, Martinez had great concentration the whole year. He's a real good athlete, has a lively arm. He's going on 240 innings. He's a good battler, and he pitches his best when he's in trouble.
The other veteran of the starting staff is Bryn Smith, who's been giving Expos fans good vibrations since he joined the team in 1981. The closest thing the Expos have to a Beach Boy, the affable right-hander from California, posted 10 or more wins for the fifth straight season, a feat eclipsed only by Steve Rogers.
I've always felt that if I can just play well enough to give me the baseball for one more year, that I'll be ready when the time comes. And who knows, they just keep piling up, and until somebody tells me I can't pitch or play anymore, I'll still be here.
And what of our fallen hero, our injured entertainer, felled by a fractured finger earlier in the season? Well, he returned to the lineup after 45 days on the disabled list and picked up right where he left off. They froze at his slow stuff. They flailed at his fast stuff. Don't worry, be happy.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now.
You know, I don't worry about nothing when I be up there in the mound, you know. I know people like to see don't me worry. Pitch, and they think, you know, I put in show, you know, but be I'm really aggressive, you know. I think I burned that way, you know, and it's the way I play. I think people love that.
There's no dull moment. There's no looking around or anything. You got to keep your eye on Pascoe. You never know what he's going to do next.
Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy.
With temperatures soaring on the field, tempers at times were just as hot. Hubie Brooks could not be counted as one of Smiley's people on this fight night at Three Rivers Stadium. William straightens. But more often than not, Hubie let his bat do the talking, as on this occasion. His contributions were more than just hot air. Playing a new position, questions about his defense in right field were answered early. He showed he could catch, and they knew he could throw.
Umpire Bob Davidson with the call right on time.
I like to play when it matters. If the game is on the line, I'd like to be the one to decide what's going to happen.
Every year, certain facets stand out with certain teams. For the Expos, it has become their extra inning magic. With their balanced bullpen, they've pulled off escapes worthy of Harry Houdini. With the clutch hitting off the bench, they have an extra inning arrogance born of repeated success. The Expos won 18 extra inning games in 1988, one shy of the major league record set by the 1959 Pittsburgh Pirates. Over the last two seasons, the Expos have won 30 games in extra innings. The best in the major leagues.
With the game, 4-3.
The most pleasant surprise for the Expos in 1988 turned out to be a hard-hitting rookie catcher, Nelson Santovania. When he wasn't the one who was hitting, he was the one who was being hit. He plays the hard-nosed brand of defense that is a throwback to the old days. And speaking of throwbacks, he is not at all reluctant to show off a fine arm to all bases. Santovania was indeed a revelation to the Expos and their fans. The biggest series of the season, New York, mid-August. The Expos at 6.5 games back, 4 games against the Mets. Santovania finds a soft place to land for the game-winning hit, 5.5 back. Game 2, Tracy Jones with a line drive to left. Expos win. Buck Rogers is happy. The Expos move to 4.5. Game 3. Foley and a home run, giving the Expos an early lead. Visions of 3.5 dance in their heads. But a Tim Tuffle sacrifice fly caps a Mets comeback in game 1 of a twin bill. The Expos need a split. Game 4 of the series, Howard Johnson dials 8 for long distance on a room service breaking ball. 6.5 games back and never that close again. Time to look at the baby boomers of the starting rotation. There was John Dobson, the first to be recalled. Dobson was a hard luck rookie hurler who was dealt to the Red Sox for shortstop Spike Owen. We'll be right back. Then came former first-round draft choice Brian Holman, a curveball specialist with a major league fastball and unlimited potential. Finally, left-hander Randy Johnson, head and shoulders above the opposition. He made his debut amid such hoopla and hype about his height, but left a more lasting impression by winning his first three starts as an Expo.
You took a look at the defense.
Down on the farm, Indianapolis, under manager Joe Sparks, won its third straight American Association championship, going one step further in 1988 by beating Rochester for the first AAA Alliance overall title.
They just keep getting better, you know? I just really love my players.
This, plus the scouting and total farm performance, prompted Baseball America to vote the Expos Major League Organization of the Year.
Just looking at Montreal this year, they had a great minor league winning record, but more important, they've got some great talent coming through, some great young ball players. So we just felt, just everything considered, they were the organization of the year.
I think in the next year and a half to 2 years, you'll see an influx of good young players pitching, and also some impact position players.
Well, you try to build a pride in a uniform. So when you have, when somebody puts on a Montreal Expo uniform, it's a special feeling. And that you pull and you put on that uniform, you know you're somebody special.
The Expo's decision makers are young and aggressive, a new generation of baseball minds that have already taken steps toward a winning major league team in 1989.
There's nothing like winning, and all of a sudden when you have the clinch a division championship or a playoffs and everybody hugging one another and the champagne pouring, it just, you can't describe the feeling. It's a chill that goes into you, and that's what we're all shooting for, and hopefully this talent will make us be able to do that in the near future.
The Montreal Expos, the next generation, has been brought to you by Labatt, brewers of 50 Ale.
Under tropical skies, entertainment stars join Bob Hope's Easter in the Bahamas tonight at 8. And later at 9, an overprotective mom dons battle fatigues when her son joins the Army. Barbara Eden stars in the madcap military comedy, Your Mother Wears Combat Boots.